Hey, Remarkable Lifers, this is KJ, and today we are on the Chapala Malico. We're actually over here looking at Lago Chapala, and we have some friends with us, and I have a very interesting story for you. So,
seems like forever since we've been together. Oh, God, I reach your letters and look at your pictures. Oh God, I miss you so bad.
So when Craig was in high school, he was given a pen pal through his Spanish class, and they began exchanging letters, and they have stayed in contact for over 35 years. And they met once back in the 90s in New Orleans, and then she came home to Mexico City. Her and her son now live in Holland, and they're here. They came to Mexico City to visit family and whatnot, and while they were here, decided to come up to Akihik and visit with us. And I would love for you guys to meet them.
Hi.
Hi.
Esta es mi amiga Marta y
Hola.
Su hijo Emilio. So this is my friend Marta and her son Emilio.
Hey, Remarkable Lifers. This is Craig, and I'm here with somebody very special to me and to us. My friend Marta.
Hi.
Marta is a friend of mine that I have known for 35 years. Don't tell anybody. We met through a pen pal program in our Spanish/English courses in high school. And we started to be pen pals, and it just continued from there. So I'm going to tell you about what my experience was, you know, getting that, or, you know, starting that process. So I remember I was in the Spanish class, was in the ninth grade, and they offered us the opportunity to have a Spanish speaking pen pal, and I jumped on it. I'm like, yes. And I had like three or four. I know, I'm sorry, you weren't the only one. That they give you several, and I had somebody from France, and somebody, you know, the only person that ever wrote back to me more than one letter was Marta. So I just was so intrigued, and you know, it was such an escape for me to learn about someone new, you know, a new culture, someone's life in another country was so interesting to me. Gee, go figure, and here we are, living in Mexico. But that first letter you send, and you kind of forget about it, and you get one back, and you're like, wow, they actually wrote things. And so, over the years, it really went from being more about us just telling each other about our lives and sharing things. And then eventually it went into, you know, big things happen in your life and you start sharing some of those things. And the interesting thing is there's, and we'll talk about that later, is about what you don't share. You know, you might not get into some of the deeper stuff because it's just letters. But over the years, and then we get together, you know, you get to have those conversations. For me, 35 years later, we have only met twice. This is our second time. And Marta had some family things come up and was able to travel to Mexico City and made a drive to here. So we're going to hear from you now. You tell me what it was like to get your message.
I remember I studied in a bilingual school, so we had a lot of English classes. And the teacher came one day and said, who wants to get a pen pal? And you gotta give here your address. So I did that. Same, mm-hmm. You know, you just write or hope that somebody would write to you. Mm-hmm. And I also had a bunch of mm-hmm. prospects. and you get lots of letters mm-hmm. at the beginning, and I remember the excitement, or this is years ago, this is way before internet, WhatsApp, Facebook and all that, so the only thing you can get to know people from another country was through letters. Mm-hmm. So I remember the excitement of opening the mailbox and seeing a letter, you know, addressed to you, and stamps and paper and reading. Mm-hmm. Some people would tell short things, and some other people never wrote back. Mm-hmm. Like, you would write a letter and never hear from them again. From very early on, I was very interested in other cultures, just like you. I think that's what brought us together. We were genuinely interested in getting to know people from other countries, other cultures, and we were really interested and sincere about this curiosity. Mm-hmm. No wonder we got friends, because mm-hmm. we share that genuine interest and really, you know, making questions and, you know, wanting to know more about the other person. Okay, so it was a different culture. How do you do that? And I believe when you write, you share more than you would share face to face.
Right, right.
There's, of course, things you might not always share, but I remember we used to write long letters.
Mm-hmm.
And when I say long, I don't mean one page or two, it would be six pages both sides.
Yes.
For
yes.
sure. And that's also something we have in common. You would do that, I would do that too.
We're both writers by nature.
We're both writers, and we both like languages, mm-hmm. and we both like, you know, the power of words. We believe in the power of words. So at the beginning, you know, where you live, what you do, mm-hmm. where you study, and, you know, in the years, you get to more deeper stuff or personal stuff.
Yeah.
And I don't remember where I wrote.
But
I guess we wrote about very, you know, important stuff. It would be really nice to get our letters together one time and go through all those, because we grew up together.
Yes.
Literally, we grew up together.
We
went through high school together. Then you got into college. I did too. I remember sharing important, you know, highlights of our mm-hmm. life. Like, now we're graduated. Congratulations mm-hmm. on sending presents to each other. Mm-hmm. Like, little things that you could post, that you could send in a mail. You know,
which I still have.
Which I still do too. Like, certain things that you were like, oh, this is so nice. You know, somebody who would be in another part of the world think about you and sending you something that you think the other person is gonna like.
Mm-hmm.
So we got really personal at some point.
We did.
I think it is quite remarkable that we both had them. That we were able to go on and on and on and on and on 3 years, even without meeting each other.
And not to interrupt, but there would be gaps. You know, something would happen.
Would
we
gaps.
Would get busy, or we would just, I got so busy, I forgot to write, and you would go for a long period of time, and then you'd get this letter. It's like, I am so sorry, my friend. I have been so busy. Here's an update on fill you in, and then we would be back to it for a while.
And then 6 pages later,
yes.
we would update ourselves in our lives. And a lot of things have happened through the years. I moved to another country, and then the distance was even bigger. And then we lost kind of touch for some years. Then we became friends in Facebook mm-hmm. and kind of like got started again. It's funny, sometimes we don't even write, but you see my pictures and I see your mm-hmm. pictures, and I kind of know what's going on in your life. And sometimes even a short flight, like, hey, I think of you, congratulations mm-hmm. or whatever, then that's enough.
Because by
that point we had built a friendship, a true friendship, that you don't need a lot of words.
Right.
Or not everyday contact, or not even every month contact, but somehow, I don't know how mm-hmm. we did it, I'm very proud of ourselves.
I am too.
We got to be in contact, in touch for so long.
Yeah. And the really great part is, you know, I can remember being, you know, in my 30s, and I had a relationship that broke up, and I remember, like, I was, you know, I was down, I was sad, I was trying to get my life back together, and I just remember going, I want to tell Marco, and I messaged you, and I'm like, hey, I just want to share this with you. You know, I just went through this breakup. And then all of a sudden, boom, you know, we hadn't talked for a while. And then we're chatting back and forth, you know, on social media for a little while. Or email. I think it was email at that point.
It was probably email at some point.
And then, okay, I'm okay. And I'm okay too. And so that support, it was so interesting. That support was always there. And I hope I could offer that to you too. And as much as we wanted to share. It wasn't, you know.
But we did share a lot, and what amazes me is that how, it's hard for me to explain how well we love each other.
Absolutely.
And how did we get to that point without even meet? Ever.
Yes.
Until 1991, I was in New Orleans.
Yeah.
You came over. I remember your mother saying, you know, this is probably the closest time you're going to be to your friend, your friend. So here's the money, buy a ticket, go to New Orleans.
Yes, my mom stepped in and handed me the money. I paid it back. But she gave me the money to go, and it was great. I think, and you know, there's a little bit of awkwardness. You're like, oh my gosh, I'm meeting this person for the first time. But we really just kind of clicked and just let it be
whatever.
It's like
we knew each other.
We let it be what it was.
Which we did.
There were no expectations.
There were not. Well, no. And then we knew each other quite well by then. And it was, you know, it was a very funny thing. Like, you came in. I remember I opened the door. It wasn't even my house. I was a visitor.
Mm-hmm.
And you came over and I was like, hey, how are you?
Yeah.
Yeah, like,
oh my gosh, big hugs, and here's my friends, and you know, and all of a sudden I was just a part of the group, and it was wonderful. And the same thing happened here. I mean, we met, we were like running like hugs, you know, when she first got here.
I was jumping with excitement. And it's very funny because we've been friends for so many years, but this is the second time we met. This is, if we count in hours, it's like, how many hours have we met? For
right.
real. How
right.
many years have we met?
Yeah.
You know, through words, through writing. I think that the secret to our friendship, if there is some, is that we've always been sincere.
Mm-hmm.
We've always been true. You know, I might not tell you everything, but everything that I told you was real, was true.
And the same thing.
So that's how you build friendships. And this is, to me, a very special friendship because it's probably my oldest friendship ever,
it is mine.
We've been through so many things together, and it is a true relationship, even if it is not real in the sense of touching each other.
Right.
So this
Well,
is
I don't know. I just felt you touch me, so we made that happen, you know?
After so many years. And then one day, I read in social media and in your Instagram page, you started your YouTube channel, mm-hmm. so I followed along, and So I kind of saw what you were going up to, and at some point I remember you posting this, like, we're moving to Ajijic. I'm like, no, you said, I'm moving to Mexico.
Mm-hmm.
I said, you gotta be kidding me.
I remember getting a message, and she was like, what?
I'm like, this is not possible. Like, how would you imagine 35 years later, you're coming to live in my country? I don't even live here anymore.
Right. She's like, wrong place.
Wrong timing.
Yeah. So that's the funny part is that we have, you know, the kind of the timeline of that is that, you know, we got the pen pal, we wrote back and forth to each other, and then Marta moved to Holland. Then she got married and had a child, and that's the other great thing is I got to meet her awesome kid. She brought him with her. We ended up moving across, well, I was all over the place in the States, but then I moved to Mexico. So it's like 35 years later, I start out learning about Mexico City, and now I live in Mexico, and we get to connect back here in Mexico. Blew my mind. So
it is. Yeah. It is overwhelming.
And she's, even though my Spanish skills are terrible, I've learned I have some sort of block. It takes me more to learn it than some people. But I'm so, hola, mi amigo, mi amiga, you know, and I'm like, watch, I can speak Spanish now. She's like, you're getting there. But she is actually, one thing I want to share with you is, Marta is actually a Spanish teacher in Holland. So I find that to be interesting in having our channel be about moving to a new culture. We have someone here who has done that as well in the opposite way. So tell me a little bit about what it was like for you, and maybe whatever you want to say about moving to another country,
to a completely different country. It just happened. It was not something that I planned, like, I want to move somewhere else. I was always curious about other languages, other cultures. I traveled as well. At some point, I decided to sell everything, and I sold my car, I sold my computer, I sold my phone, I sold my furniture, I gave up my job, and I went on a dream trip to Europe for almost 2 years. I was traveling with my backpack, you know, following around, and I had, you know, certain things that I wanted to do. I wanted to learn French, and I wanted to see all the sights, and I wanted to do a lot of things. And, well, I met the Dutch guy, and okay, long story short, I moved to Holland after some time. I've always loved languages. Before this big trip, when I went to school, when I went to university, I decided to study Spanish because I love books and I love languages. So I went to teach learning. I did a major in literature and language, Spanish language. And then I remember telling my father, like, I want to study literature. And my father was like, okay. You can do whatever you want with your life, but literature, what are you going to do for, you know, mm-hmm. putting bread on the table? And I remember him telling me, why don't you study to become an English teacher? Because my English was pretty good mm-hmm. at the time. So I was like, teacher? Oh, no. Because my mother was an English teacher. My father was a teacher for some years. All the sisters of my mother were teachers. All the brothers of my father are teachers. So I was like, teacher, I'm not like you. I'm different. Mm-hmm. So I didn't want to do that. So my father insisted, you just get a diploma to become an English teacher. And it will help you out maybe in the future. I was like, mm-hmm. no. But he insisted. And so at some point I said, okay, shut up. I'll do it just to shut you up. And don't bother me. So I did, and funny enough, I still remember that to this day. The first time we had to do like some practice teaching mm-hmm. with my peer students, I remember stepping in front of the class for the first time, and I was like, suddenly, like a fish in the water. I don't know what it is. I don't know if it is genetic. I don't know what it is. It just felt natural. And I've been a language teacher ever since. I've never had any other job. I started teaching English for many years. I love languages. I love, I believe that language is just a way to get to know people from other cultures. Language is grammar and pronunciation and vocabulary, but further than that, I think it's just a way to get to know people and to learn about people, other people. So when I was traveling in Europe, one of my main goals was to study French because I love mm-hmm. French. And then I met this Dutch guy, and then I moved there, and then I had the whole experience of learning another culture, another language, and another mm-hmm. way of thinking, living. I thought it would be easier. I honestly mm-hmm. thought, 6 months,
yeah,
I'll do it. No. It took me really long. Dutch yeah. is a challenging language for Spanish speaking people. I don't know, but it was a challenge, and it was a nice challenge because I've always been interested. There, at some point, my ex husband and I, we had this discussion like, should we live in Mexico or do you come to Holland? I was like, no, I want to go there because I know Mexico, and I don't know Holland, so I want to learn. I want to get to know another culture, another language. So when I moved there, people always ask me, what do you miss more? Like, well, my family and the sun and the food and my friends. And I think what I miss most is the warmth of the people. I don't know if it's because I'm from Mexico and I'm Mexican, I feel immediately, but I don't know, but you have it. We've talked about it. No, yes. You feel the warmth of the people. People are just, yes. Relaxed.
There really is something different here in Mexico about just the warmth and the help and the kindness. It's built in. It's just part of you, your family. If you are there,
and it's very spontaneous.
If you're in their house, yeah. If you're in their home, you're family.
Yeah.
You don't get, you're not an outsider if you're inside their home. Your family, and it's just amazing, and that I can see that where a different culture would have more of a, maybe a more regimented, or a more.
Not everybody's the same, which is fine. Yeah. I mean, we're all different. It takes time to. At the beginning, I thought it was about me. Now, I did something wrong. I said something wrong. It's just you get to know the culture. It takes time, but it's also interesting, and it's a nice journey.
It is.
To this day, well, I. I'm never going to be Dutch, and I'm always going to be Mexican. But it's also nice to get the nice thing of your culture. Not everything is nice about Mexico. There are things that I don't like.
Right.
And I think the best thing is to get best out of both worlds.
Absolutely.
To blend.
So, which is really interesting that you now not only speak Spanish and English and Dutch, but you now teach Dutch, or Spanish. Teach Dutch people Spanish, yes. Which is just like, okay, also, who'd have thought I'd end up there, kind of a feeling. But the great thing is that her son, who lives there in Holland with them, is, I think, trilingual or multilingual, let's put it that way, speaks Dutch and was raised speaking Spanish, and we have discovered speaks wonderful English. So what was, I mean, tell me about that.
I think it was, at that moment, I raising my kid bilingual was a given. It was not, there was not even a question about it. To me, language comes out of your heart. To me, Spanish comes out of my heart. So I could not speak Spanish to my kid. It was like completely unthinkable. So we made a very conscious decision. This kid is going to be raised bilingual. Not all kids are alike, and you might try and not work out. I was lucky enough to have a kid that is also curious. Well, his father has also this multicultural background, mm-hmm. So he was born into this multicultural, open, curious environment. And genetic, probably, because I remember him, he was very little, he was very curious. How do you say this in Spanish? How do you say this in Spanish? So he almost naturally wanted to take part in conversations. For me, it was very important that he could, whenever we came back or whenever we are in close contact with some people in my family, even when we're there, Skype or WhatsApp or whatever. So it was very, for me, it was very important that he would be part of that conversation and not feel left out. And I truly believe that when you know the language, a little bit at least, you experience the trip, the traveling, the stay in another country completely different if you understand a little bit of the language and you can, you know, take active part in whatever it is.
I agree.
This trip was thought about because of that, and also what I wanted with this trip and come and visit you guys was for me to get exposed to English now, mm-hmm. as well, which we don't do in a regular basis back home. But also, and this is probably for you the first time, mm-hmm. you hear, but for me it was very important. For me it was important that he saw true friendship. It is important that he sees what family is, mm-hmm. not that he sees, but that he experiences and that he lives in it, that he, you know, gets in this pool of love, as mm-hmm. I call it, you know, just family and friends. And you can teach a kid a lot of things by saying, yeah, what you need to do is this and that, and what you need, but when you just share your life, you don't need to say it. He just sees it and feels it and understands how important it is to have friends.
Yes.
And how important it is because friendship is just not something that just happens magically.
No.
You have to make it grow, to help it grow.
As we say in the United States, it's a two-way street.
It's a two-way street, but it's also like a little plant. You have to water the little mm-hmm. plant. It just doesn't grow like that. So you have to give.
Yes.
And you have to invest time mm-hmm. in your relationships in general. Exactly. So to me, my friends in Holland, my family and friends in Mexico, and now you guys, I want him to grow with that sense of family, friends, and real relationships. I think that for us was different. We grew up with telephone mm-hmm. and letters, and you know, just go visit your friend.
Right.
And friendships now tend to be more virtual.
Yes.
And they tend to have less real contact. But this is also important.
Oh,
this
absolutely.
This is also important.
Yes, you take the new and you embrace that and you build it into, but you don't forget about.
You don't forget really about to, what really
builds. You really have to touch, you have to see, you have to be in one place, yes.
And hugging is important, and smiling is important, and you know, this laughing together is important. And I've said it a couple of times to her, you know, my people is my treasure.
Mm-hmm.
It is not about money, it's not about a big house or a big car. It is, my treasure is my people. You have to work towards it. And 35 years later, mm-hmm. we've got this huge
yes.
treasure.
Yes.
And I want to share it with him, you know? Yes. This is what life is about. Yes.
And now we are actually planning that we are looking at what are our next steps? So we're in that phase of our lives where we're like, yeah. Okay, so we're not as busy anymore. And we're starting to realize, I mean, we've always realized it, but we're starting to go, wait a minute, why aren't we visiting more? And so we actually have some plans, announcement, to kind of make sure that relationship continues in the direction it's going and that we foster that. We are planning to go see her and Emilio and family in Mexico City when she's here. But also, big announcement, in 2024, we are working on a plan to go to Europe. So we are trying to go to the British Isles, and we're building in a little time to make sure we go and experience
yes.
their life in their home. So that's our story. And we actually realize it's a pretty special story.
It is.
This scenario does not happen very often.
It is.
I will say that she's one of my dearest friends in life. And this has been like, KJ's like, Craig, you're just smiling constantly.
And people don't get it.
I was telling
my friends in Mexico, my family, I'm going to Ajijic. And they're like, where are you going? I want to see my friend. I've never seen him. This is the second time, but he's my dear friend. And people are like, huh?
When you go to the, you're going to
be
murdered.
Yeah. Somebody that you have never met. And it is.
We have met.
We yes. Well, okay,
well
we've
no,
met
I mean,
once.
No, I mean, like, we've connected so much. We really do know each other. And so it's like you meet someone, you meet them on a much deeper level when you're writing and you're putting that.
I think so too.
You're sharing different things that make you more connected. So, yeah, we're going to work really hard to try to keep that loud noise. Sorry. We're going to try to keep that and build that even further and just become true family over the years. And I think it's wonderful. One thing to note, and I'll embarrass Marta, but she is a Spanish teacher. She does speak English and Dutch. And so while, you know, serious Spanish teacher. So if you're interested in something serious in your Spanish education, if you're coming to Mexico and you want to learn, a native Spanish speaker from Mexico, reach out to us and maybe we can connect you. And, you know, if it's the right fit, you guys can go with that. But if not, I hope that this was a valuable conversation for you to see that you can be friends across the miles and that you can really invest in a new country and you can grow through that.
True friends are forever.
I agree.
No matter how many miles and years and whatever happens in between, when you have a true friend, it will last forever.
And what you don't know is that we've had a few days together. We've had a remarkable few days. I mean, just a lot of fun.
Wonderful. We don't want to go.
Yeah, no.
We don't want to go.
But they're literally getting in the car and leaving after this interview.
Yes.
And so this
exactly.
is an actual...
But this is not a goodbye.
No, this is until next time.
See you later.
Hasta mañana. Hasta luego.
Hasta pronto.
Hasta pronto. See you soon. Si.
Hasta pronto.
Si. She corrects me and I love it. I get to learn. No, it's wonderful. And I just want to encourage everybody out there to embrace the culture when you move to Mexico, or if you're moving to any other country, truly embrace the culture, embrace the people, and you will grow beyond your wildest dreams. So,
keep your hearts open.
Absolutely. So,
if you haven't already,
go find your truly remarkable life.
Yay.
Love ya.
Seems like forever.
Love you. Bye.
Yes.
Oh, God, I miss you, Pat. And I read your letters and look at your pictures. Oh, God, I miss you so bad. It's been so long, I know, but I'm finally coming home. Till then I'm dreaming of your heart, your eyes, our love. See your